There's another political tendency that I'd first like to ask you to define in your terms, because not everyone is in agreement over it. And also people are saying it's a moment in the sun, a political moment is past, and that's neoliberalism.
Yeah.
How, first of all, how would you do, in one phrase, how would you define neoliberalism, and when would, and talk a little bit about its trajectory over the past 20 years?
Well, neoliberalism refers to the attempt of basically right-wing forces in the United in the Western world and in the capitalist world to roll back everything that moved in directions they didn't like in the period 1945 to 1970. They wanted to roll back basically wage levels. They wanted to roll back environmental legislation. They wanted to roll back government control of or interference with or regulation of industries, etc. And they wanted to roll back the decline of the United States. They rolled it back. They rolled it back. But as with all these, this is a regular phenomenon where you hit a Kondratiev B phase, which we've been in since the early 1970s, and the rollback is always less than the roll up. So it's two steps up and one step down. And we're one step down. But if you take wage levels, or you take environmental legislation, or you take U.S. power, and you just compare it not with 1970, it's rolled back from that, but with 1945, you'll see that from 45 to 2010, it's an upward curve. That the rollback is and the rollback ended. We're now moving in the other direction again, politically, and we have been actually for about 10 years. So neoliberalism as a phenomenon, as a label, which it was always a bad label, and it always suggested something that was not a regular phenomenon of the capitalist world economy, but its day is done. And the place to look, if you want to see that its day is done, is the International Monetary Fund. The International Monetary Fund today speaks language that is anti-neoliberal. They are the ones who say you got to worry about poverty. You got to worry about. I mean, you know, they're practically left wing in the tonality of their language, and they of course were the big operators, the operating mechanism of neoliberalism during its heyday. They have recognized that they have to change their line in order to survive and to pursue their objectives. Their objectives haven't changed, but the political ambiance in the world system has changed, and they recognize it. The people who don't recognize it are the dunces of the world, who are still trying to pursue a kind of pure neoliberal line. Look what's happened just with the business of the Republicans in the United States on the business of Medicaid, right? So they rolled out this thing with Representative Ryan. They passed it in the House of Representatives magnificently and so forth. And then they all went home to their districts, and they discovered that people were unhappy with them. And now, in the last few weeks, all sorts of Republicans are retreating on that. That doesn't mean they don't want to do it. That means they realize that politically it's not possible to do or not do as much as and as badly as they wanted to do it. Well, that's all part of the passing of neoliberalism, the passing of the whole business about globalization and so forth and so on. Where we've always been in a globalized world, if you mean a world in which one had to take into account what was going on everywhere, and that trade and where production crossed national boundaries, that's been going on for 500 years. But if you mean there is no alternative, you know what the answer to there is no alternative is? It's Tata. There are thousands of alternatives. And people are beginning to realize there are thousands of alternatives, and it doesn't work anymore. And you can defy, and you get away with defying. When you refuse to give in to various things, then it's the United States or it's the IMF or which has to bend, and not necessarily as 20 years ago the governments of these various countries. So yeah, its moment is gone. It doesn't mean these forces have changed their general view, but their power is less.
So when I say T.I.N.A, you say T.A.T.A?
Yeah.
Wait, there's something that I wanted to ask you. Okay, well then, some people might take what you just said to mean, I'm just going to vulgarize it a little bit.
Sure.
As often, you know, like if say I was speaking to a high school student or something, and I say, wait, are you saying, so now things are going to get better or more, you know, there's going to be, are there, does that mean there's going to be welfare programs and then
no.
You start funny?
No, I'm not saying that. I'm saying now that there's a real political struggle going on, right? And the first thing you have to realize is that the nature of the economic situation in the world today, right now, is one of enormous chaos, and that means enormous fluctuations, so that everything goes up and down very fast, politically, economically, socially. One day this, the next day the opposite, and it's very hard to predict, and people don't like that, That's absolutely true, but capitalists don't like that either, because you have to have a certain amount, a certain degree of stability in order just to make rational, from a capitalist point of view, rational decisions. You can't invest in something and then have the currency collapse on you the next day and then go up 3 weeks later. You just can't operate that way. But that's the situation we're in. We're in that kind of situation, and therefore, first of all, politically, that means everybody is very uncertain what's going to happen, and they react in how shall I say, emotional ways. Of course, they're emotional. Their livelihoods are at stake, and it's not merely the ordinary guy. Who lives on very little, who's worried about his livelihood being at stake, but the small businessman, the middle-sized businessman, the big-sized businessman are also in the same kind of dilemma. So that's where we are, and that's the kind of struggle that's going on now. Now, within that framework, people are trying to carve out the future, and it's not so easy to carve out the future, and therefore it's highly unpredictable what kind of future we're going to collectively carve out.
So does that mean that when you say that the rollback has been rolled back, so are you saying that there's a more of a historical movement toward trying to stabilize that, so to get rid of that chaos?
No. What I'm saying is, roughly from about 1975-80 to about 1995, it was a question. T.I.N.A did prevail. That is to say, the strong forces of pushing back all kinds of progressive things on the world scale operated very well. People were intimidated and so forth. That moment in which they just got their way in country after country, in situation after situation, that's over. It's no longer that. It's a much more even struggle. There's still a struggle. There's still fighting. So, you know, you have to worry about whether the unions are going to be outlawed in this state in the United States, whether budgets are going to be cut in a terrible way over there, and so forth. There's real political struggle that's going on. It's simply that the forces are not so lopsided as they were for about 15 years, in which basically the reactionary forces of the world system had their way. They no longer are in that kind of controlling situation. They are faced with all opposite forces that are also fairly strong and are fighting them.